Well, tonight's message is based on Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And I invite you to turn with me there as we read our scripture reading. And we're going to read verses 11 through 16. 11 through 16. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Now there's a lot in those verses, and I've seen some things in these verses as I was preparing for this message that I hadn't really noticed before. And we're going to take a look at some of those things together. First of all, consider the fact that the work of perfecting continues until something is achieved. What is that that it achieves? That's right. Till we all come in the unity of the faith. That's the goal of the perfection, or the result of the perfection. I read a statement by someone recently that said that unity brings about trying to not misstate it, but essentially that unity comes first, and then unity of doctrine. Now, I want us to think about that for a few minutes here, and really examine which does come first. Does unity come first and then doctrinal unity? Or does doctrinal unity come and then unity? But we'll let you think about that for a few moments, and we're going to come back and have a look at that question, as well as some others. Something else I want us to notice, though, as we're looking at this passage, notice that it speaks about, in verse 12, the perfecting of the saints. The perfecting is a progressive work. Notice that in that state, it's not a finished work. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till something is reached, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man. So what I'm seeing, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm seeing that perfection, not the perfecting, but the perfection, is synonymous with the unity of the faith. Let me read the verse again. I'll start with verse 12. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So what I'm seeing here is that unity and perfection are used synonymously. That's what is reached by the ministry of the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers. Now, what are these offices, what are these people in these positions doing? What do they all have in common?
They're teaching doctrine.
They're teaching doctrine, they're teaching the Word of God, they're preaching, whether it's an evangelistic sermon or whether it's in a schoolroom or a Sabbath school or from the pulpit or in all these various ways, they're speaking the Word of God. So the Word of God results in the perfection / unity. And notice what results, or what the symptom is the wrong word, but the characteristic of this unity is, we can look in verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of man and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. So when this unity is achieved, when this perfect man is achieved, there's not going to be the being blown about by every wind of doctrine. Now, in the process of this ministry of the apostles and the prophets and the evangelists and pastors and teachers, verse 15 tells us, but speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things which is the head, even Christ. So the truth, the Word of God, is being presented with love, and that is doing a work in the lives of the believers that results in what it terms here in verse 13, a perfect man, and synonymous with unity of the faith. Now, I hope I'm understanding that correctly. I want us to consider, first of all, in this context, perfection on a physical level in relationship to this unity that we're talking about. In the physiology of the human body, every member has to act in harmony and in perfect balance with every other member of the body. We have the stomach, which has to produce digestive juices, not in the middle of the night when there's no food there. That's going to cause ulcers. It needs to produce the digestive fluids when the mouth is eating. And the mouth can only be eating when the hand is working in harmony with that, putting food in the mouth. We have this balance that has to take place, this unison, and every part working in harmony with one another. And that brings about, that facilitates the perfecting of the body on a physical level. When the legs are exercising, running, the heart needs to pump faster to get the blood circulating to keep up with the work that the legs are doing. There has to be this unity of the members in order to have physical perfection. Now, moving to the spiritual aspect or the mental aspect, consider the same, looking at the same perspective of unity and perfection being synonymous. In our minds, we have a number of different faculties. We have faculties of faith, judgment, will, choice, conscience, memories, all of these different various functions. There's also faculties which tend to the ministering of the body. When the human aspect of the mind, for using the word in a strictly definition aspect of the word, carnal, not in an evil sense, but when the human or the carnal part of the mind is thinking that it needs food at the right time, and we're on our way to the house to satisfy that need, and we see an injured child that needs a bandage, at that point in time, we need to know the proper place for that part of the mind that is wanting to satisfy its physical needs. At that point in time, there needs to be a higher and a different faculty of the mind that is holding the reins.
That's right.
And says, no, this child needs care and help first, and the physical needs will come secondary. And so we need to have each faculty of the mind in its proper sphere, working in balance and in harmony with all of the other aspects of the mind. And another example is when we are planning, when just the human animal part of the brain is saying, I need to take care of myself, feed myself, take care of my family. And so we are planning business transactions, planning, making a business plan, etc. And Sabbath rolls around. Well, there's nothing evil or wrong about making business plans, about making plans to feed yourself. But when Sabbath rolls around, there's a different faculty of the mind that needs to take the reins and say, it's time to stop and put those thoughts away and choose to think about other things. There needs to be a proper unity and balance between the different faculties of the mind in order to have mental and spiritual perfection. Another example, when reason, which is simply a human faculty of the mind, when reason tells me that if I step out of the boat, I'm going to sink. But then the other faculty of faith steps in and says, no, but Jesus has said to get out of the boat and walk. At that point in time, I need to keep the proper balance between reason and faith. Mm-hmm. And faith needs to have the ascendancy and say, no, Jesus has commanded, and I am going to obey, amen, regardless of what reason tells me. Mm-hmm. So these are some examples of the proper balance mentally that will achieve this unity or perfection on a mental level. Each faculty knowing its proper place. When we're told in the scriptures that everyone is given a measure of faith. Faith is not something which is otherwise natural to the human heart. At what point in time are we given faith? It can't be at conversion, because not everybody's converted, and faith is given to every man.
Start exercising.
Now, these different faculties that we're given need to be exercised and strengthened. Okay, what about the faculty of the will, the faculty of choice? If we're left to ourselves, would we have the faculty of choice?
No.
Satan robbed us of that. But we need to understand that the atonement has reached every child of Adam.
Amen.
And brought the possibility of every child of Adam to choose the right.
Amen.
Every child has a conscience. And it's only as they grow older that they lose that tender conscience. Every child has a measure of faith. Were it not for this atonement, we could not have these precious privileges. We could not have the power to accept Christ into our life, the power to choose. Now, moving over to the realm of the relationships, the realm of the church, perfection within the church, unity within the church. We need to apply the same principles that we applied in the physical realm and in the mental realm, in the personal realm and the church realm. Perfection is shown to be synonymous with unity. How do we get this unity? Let's notice once again in Ephesians 4, verse 11. He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Now, why do we need these people for unity?
They're part of the body of Christ.
You worked earlier.
It's working on there, but not up there. Just for those of you watching online, we're trying to get the slides to advance here, so bear with us just a moment. But we see here that all of these different offices that are required for the perfecting of the saints have what we talked about a little while ago, something in common, and that is that they're sharing the word of God. And this is why in John 17:17 it says, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. So sanctification comes through the word. We can't be united unless we're sanctified.
That's right.
So which comes first? The truth has to come first. And then the sanctification or the perfection and the unity. Okay, so I hope that that is clear. But the offices described here are very different from just an MC or a drill sergeant or a public speaker or a choir director.
Which one do you want to go to?
Next one. Okay. Let's see if this works. Now, here's a type of unity, right? We have a bunch of schoolgirls and boys dressed up in their uniforms. They're all dressed the same. On the outwardly, they're united. Here, not only are they dressed alike, but they're walking, they're moving alike. They're perfectly united, every foot, every leg, their form, they're united. You know, I've seen these video clips of ball games or something where they have cheerleaders and they do these figures. They form different letters of the alphabet or different designs, logos and things, just holding different colors or dressed differently, and then they come and they form these different things, and they're all working together simultaneously. But that's not the unity that this is talking about. These people are all singing the same thing, the same song. They're playing the same song. And they're even united in harmonious notes. But that's not the unity that we're looking for. These people are all attending a family camp in Indiana. A camp meeting is not the unity that we're looking for, being able to attend a camp meeting together. That's not the unity that this is talking about. And here, they have united on certain points of doctrine. We have Tony Palmer, we have Pope Francis, we have
Kenneth Copeland.
Yes. Kenneth Copeland and other religious leaders. And they represent evangelical Protestantism and Anglicanism and Catholicism. And they don't have all the same doctrines, but they have some that they have chosen that seem to be more important than the others that unite them together. Things like Sunday keeping, the Trinity, the state of the dead, and various other things that they have viewed as important. Is that sufficient for us? Shall we come up with a little list of things, of doctrines that are important to us, that we choose to agree upon, and all those that agree can come and unite with us? I have a statement I'd like you to read to you. A few statements. I received these by email. I won't give names. But here's one that says, I personally believe that meetings like this have great potential for good and also for bad. There are a number of doctrinal positions, the disputing of which can occupy much time and may result in driving some positions and the people who hold them further apart. This is a circumstance that does not need to happen, but it is something to be mindful of. In light of that, I think we need to pray and think on what is the basis of unity we are seeking to achieve, and what is the tenor of the discussions and meetings we are hoping to have. If they are going to be doctrinal feuds, then I have misgivings, to be quite honest. I do realize also that some of these doctrinal matters need to be dealt with at some point. But there needs to be a greater purpose than just achieving doctrinal uniformity. I think a number of us have had experiences of attempting that and ending up further apart. Just think about the sentiments a little bit. Some of these doctrinal points, matters, need to be dealt with at some point. But there needs to be a greater purpose than just achieving doctrinal uniformity, etc. Okay, I'll read you another little clip from someone else. From what has been wrote out so far, I understand that the general desire is to go back to the SDA fundamentals, somehow to have the 1844 movement reborn. I understand that the general feeling is that if we would reunite in the spirit of the SDA pioneers, that would bring in the unity that the Lord Himself prayed about in John 17. If I got it wrong, then I'm both sorry and glad, but if not, please let me address a word of warning. We are not called to be Adventists, but Christians, etc. I'd like to read an article to you that I wrote that may be in your mailbox at home. But it says, I recently read an email calling for unity which stated that we are not called to be Adventists, but Christians. The author's point was that Christ, not the Adventist faith, is the foundation of our faith and the source of our unity. Though it sounds sanctimonious, it is wrong. It implies or supposes a disharmony where none exists. Those who promote the idea that holding to the Seventh-day Adventist faith is not compatible with Christianity do not understand the true Seventh-day Adventist faith. I'm reading my own words here, so. I have received many emails expressing similar sentiments and calling for unity on Christ alone, or the Father and the Son, and leaving aside our God-given Seventh-day Adventist heritage. And just to give you another example here, one individual said this, "Let us reaffirm our knowledge of the one true God and His Son in love and truth. Let this confession bind us together." The implication that I received from the entire email was that we can have that as our foundation and not too much else really matters. That's my impression, not his exact words, but I read you his exact words there. Another says, unity will not come out of doctrine. And this was our question that I posed to you. He says here, unity will not come out of doctrine, but rather shared doctrine will come out of unity. Okay, he's got it backwards here. It's completely reversed. This is because the indwelling Spirit of Christ lives within his body, the channel of blessing to save the world. It's backwards, brothers and sisters.
Amen.
He goes on to say, or another individual says, in another spot, I am also concerned that blanks commitment to the Seventh-day Adventist Foundation teachings and his concept that the teachings of Ellen White are always correct has led him to overlook or to ignore some serious problems with Adventist interpretations. And it seems to me at times that he is more committed to Adventism than he is to the Bible. Blank says that he has this attitude because he has tested Adventism by the Bible and found it stands the test in every way. I have not found this to be the case. This was not in the same thread of emails as the others, but a different email. But reading my own writing again, coming back, those who promote the idea that the holding to the Seventh-day Adventist faith is not compatible with Christianity do not understand the true Seventh-day Adventist faith. A Christian is one who professes belief in the teachings of Jesus Christ, according to Merriam-Webster. And according to Noah Webster, a real disciple of Christ, one who believes in the truth of the Christian religion and studies to follow the example and obey the precepts of Christ, a believer in Christ who is characterized by real piety. Now, those sound good. That's the definitions of a Christian. But reading on in my own words here, let it be clear that the Seventh-day Adventist faith is more than simply professing belief in the teachings of Christ, of a Christ more than, it's more than following Christ's example and precepts. It's more than some vague or nebulous calling to be in Christ. The Seventh-day Adventist faith calls one to not only follow Christ, the Christ who was upon earth 2,000 years ago, but it imparts an intelligent understanding of the types and prophecies revealing Christ's present work and location, and thus leads its adherents to follow him by faith to where he is now, in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, and to understand his work of atonement there for them. For only then can they receive the indwelling of Christ in spirit.
Amen.
Now, there may be an exception or exceptions for someone who does not know the Adventist message, who has been following all the light they have to the present. And for them to not know exactly that Christ is in the most holy place, I wouldn't think would exclude them from having the indwelling Christ. But for someone who has the truth, who knows that Jesus went into the most holy place in 1844, and that he's in the most holy place ministering in the sanctuary, a real, literal sanctuary.
Amen.
For someone to have known that and departed from it, we're not going to have the indwelling of Christ.
That's right.
It is only the Seventh-day Adventist faith which can impart true unity, because it's only the Seventh-day Adventist faith that has the present truth.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
It's only the Seventh-day Adventist faith which can impart true unity, for it is the only faith which takes its adherents by faith into the place where Christ is to be found today. We can't have unity without Christ. And if we're seeking Christ where he is not, we're not going to have him. So we can't have unity.
Amen.
The Seventh-day Adventist faith reveals the work of judgment in which Christ is now engaged and our responsibilities toward God in light of his investigation of our lives, based upon God's moral code of the Ten Commandments. Let none be mistaken. To receive the Seventh-day Adventist faith is to be a Christian, but not merely a Christian. It is a calling to be numbered among those 144,000 Christians who follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. Are we following him whithersoever he goeth? Even into the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary? And doing the work required of us in order to follow him by faith into the most holy place? Because that's a work of perfection, of character. We can't find him if we're not doing that work of perfection. He's not to be found any longer in the holy place. The Sabbath became a test. Perfection of character became a test in 1844. It is to be numbered among those 144,000 Christians who follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth, of whom it is said, here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. In order to secure unity, the Spirit of Christ will not lead us away from Christ. To retreat from the Seventh-day Adventist faith is to that of being merely Christian, is to leave Christ. It is only the Seventh-day Adventist faith that reveals where he is to be found. True unity in this antitypical Day of Atonement can only be obtained upon the foundation of the Seventh-day Adventist faith. It's not enough to have an ecumenical conference. It's not enough to simply agree that we're all going to come together in a camp meeting. This unity is not wearing the same clothes. It's not singing the same songs. It's not doing the same things or going to the same school or church. It's not attending the same camp meetings. It's a unity that goes far deeper. It's a unity of minds. It's a unity of the thoughts, the beliefs, the unity that's in Christ goes far, far deeper than any of these other places and people and groups can achieve. And that's why it tells us in verse 14 in Ephesians chapter 4 that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. So unity cannot be ecumenical. It can't be a unity that is not based and founded upon truth.
Amen.
And you know, I question, well, how much truth do we have to unite upon? And I came to conclude, that's right. We must unite upon all of it. You see, perfection is by degrees. Unity is in degrees. They have a semblance of unity. All these other groups have some unity. Right?
Yes.
They all have some unity. But if we look at this, if we look at this scripture, this unity is a perfect unity. And that's why we read here in in letter 8, 1851, I also told them, and this is by Ellen White, I also told them that the messengers of God should be perfectly united in their views of Bible truth and should consult with each other and should not advance any new view until they first went to the messengers and examined those views with the Bible. And if they were correct, let all the messengers spread them. And if they were error, lay them to one side. Then the gospel seed would be sown in union and raised in strength. And all the messengers, east and west, north and south, would be telling the same story.
Amen. Amen.
Some in recent emails that I've received and other places, other sources, have been ready to unite with anyone who is called a Christian. I don't know if I have the other, I guess not. There was another picture there of some Buddhists and Orthodox, Catholics, and Jews, and different ones, all united. Here we have a whole bunch of different religions uniting on the common belief in God, I guess. But God calls us to be united upon much more. There have been different attempts at unity throughout history. This is not one of the first ones. And my mind is recalling a time when the papacy went to the people in Bohemia and said, "We'd like to unite and just make this little concession here or that little concession there. Just allow us to preach in your churches." That was the end of the Bohemians as Christians. They lost the war. God had given them the victory on the battlefield over and over again against great odds. But now the enemy won by friendship, by association, by unity. And I pray that our eyes of discernment will be open.
Amen.
Because Satan has many tactics. He doesn't always use the open warfare. He uses apparent friendship, like he did in Balaam's day. And I'll close with that.